Lake Peigneur is located in Louisiana near the Gulf of Mexico. Before 1980, it was an approximately 10-foot deep freshwater lake with an island in the middle. Next to it, and partially underneath it, Diamond Crystal Salt Company maintained a salt mine, with salt being mined near the lake since 1919. Around large underground salt domes, you can often find oil. As explained by one Dr. Whitney J. Orton, salt moves upwards and it pierces through surrounding strata, and this piercing produces faults and folds within the surrounding sediments, producing an ideal mechanism to trap oil. As such, Texaco was doing some drilling in the lake. On November 20th, 1980, crews on the oil rig in the lake ran into a bit of a problem. At just over 1,200 feet, their drill seized up. Not a major problem normally, they worked to just get it loose. In the process, they heard several loud pops, and then the oil rig tilted like it was going to collapse. The men got off the rig and to shore as quickly as possible. Not a moment too soon, just 19 minutes after their drill had seized up, they watched from the shore as the huge platform, 150 feet tall, overturned and sunk into the 10-foot deep lake. Next, the astounded drillers watched as a whirlpool slowly formed, soon reaching a quarter mile wide and centered over the site of the oil drilling. And I suppose at this point we could say, well, whoopsie doodle. At the same time the oil workers were watching their $5 million drilling rig disappear into the lake, workers in the salt mines below the lake noticed something was wrong as well. A stream of water was found flowing along the floor of the mine shaft at about the 1,300 foot level of the mine, which went down to about 1,500 feet at its deepest. As water wasn't supposed to be in the mine, the evacuation alarm was raised. Foreman Randy LaSalle then drove a cart around to the regions of the mine where the alarm signal could not be seen, making sure everyone knew about the evacuation. By the time those from the deepest areas of the mine made it to the elevator, they encountered knee-deep water. Despite the fact that the mine was rapidly filling with water and the exit elevator could only take up 8 people at a time, all 55 miners were successfully evacuated. It wasn't clear to the miners what had happened at the time, but from the evidence at hand, the theory is that the drilling crew miscalculated their location, and instead of being several hundred feet from the salt mine, they had instead been directly over a portion of it and penetrated the salt dome. The initial hole resulting from this mistake was only 14 inches wide, but water spraying in at extremely high pressure quickly widened the hole. The water also dissolved the salt pillars that supported the ceiling of the mine, causing the shafts to collapse. The widening of the hole and the collapse of the mine gave strength to the whirlpool on the surface of the lake, which caused major damage. Docks, another drilling platform, a 70-acre island in the middle of the lake, 11 barges, vehicles, trees, and a parking lot near the lake were all sucked into the mine below. The pull of the whirlpool was so strong that it actually reversed the flow of the 12-mile-long Del Cambra Canal that drained the lake into the Gulf of Mexico. 3 hours after the first signs of trouble, the 3 to 4 billion gallons of water that had made up the lake were all gone, having dropped into the mine below, leaving a gaping crater. The backward-flowing canal formed a 160-foot waterfall that gradually refilled the lake, this time with salt water from the Gulf. The 10-foot-deep freshwater lake was now a saltwater lake, approximately 1,300 feet deep in a good-sized portion of it. Amazingly, there were no deaths or serious human injuries as a result of the disaster, though the ecosystem of the lake was forever changed. Further, 3 dogs died in the event. Many lawsuits were filed, all were settled out of court, costing Texaco about $45 million in damages, with about $32 million of that going to Diamond Crystal. And now for some bonus facts. Speaking of drilling for oil, ever wonder why oil is measured in barrels and how much that is exactly? Well, want to know more? One barrel contains 42 gallons, that's 159 liters of crude oil, from which, in the US, typically 19 gallons, 72 liters of gasoline are produced. So why barrels? The market for crude oil really took off after Abraham Gesner began distilling kerosene in 1846. The lamp oil became very popular, and as demand increased, so did the need for the crude oil that it was derived from. The first successfully drilled oil well, previously it was all gleans from natural seepage, was in Titusville, Pennsylvania, in 1859. In the mid-1800s, all liquids that needed a tight container of any size were stored in wooden barrels. Skilled coopers, barrel makers, had been producing watertight 42-gallon wooden barrels since Richard III set the size of a tierce of wine at 42 gallons in 1483 to 1484. However, to catch the oil booming from the new wells in Titusville, early producers were using any watertight container they could get their hands on, including wooden tierces, whiskey barrels, casks, and barrels of all sizes. Nonetheless, the size of the container quickly became standardized around the 42-gallon barrel due to practical considerations. As noted by the American Oil and Gas Historical Society, a 42-gallon tierce weighed more than 300 pounds, about as much as a man could reasonably wrestle. 20 would fit on a typical barge or railroad flat car. Bigger casks were unmanageable, and small were less profitable. In 1860 in Pennsylvania, the 42-gallon barrel had become standard. Because Pennsylvania was at the forefront of the early oil boom, its practices were soon adopted across the country. In 1872, 42 gallons became the standard for the Petroleum Producers Association, and in 1882, the USGS and the US Bureau of Mines adopted the standard as well. Despite transportation methods of oil evolving to the railroad tanker cars, supertankers at sea, and oil pipelines, measuring crude oil in barrels has stuck around anyway. And now for another bonus fact. Going back to natural disasters, another bizarre lake disaster of the 1980s occurred on August the 21st, 1986, when Lake Nyos in Cameroon suddenly emitted approximately 100,000 to 300,000 tons of carbon dioxide, which asphyxiated 1,700 people and 3,500 animals in nearby towns. So, how did this happen? A vein of magma lies beneath Lake Nyos. Carbon dioxide leaks from the lava into the water, resulting in the lower, cooler levels of the lake water ultimately becoming supersaturated. The lake normally remained stable this way, but a tipping point was reached on August the 21st, 1986, and the CO2 erupted from the lake in something called a limnic eruption. To prevent a recurrence, tubes have been installed that siphon water from the bottom layers of the lake to the top, allowing carbon dioxide to be vented continually over time, rather than building up. So I really hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, please do smash that like button below. Don't forget to subscribe. Also, why not go subscribe to another channel I do called Business Blaze? If you like this disaster for Texaco, I think you'll really enjoy the stuff we cover on that channel. It's a bit more laid back than this one, so please do check it out. It's linked below, and thank you for watching.